Probably need you to say a couple of things.
Okay. I'm just wondering whether or not this level of a voice and this distance is correct, so I could relax and just talk without forcing my voice. Is that loud enough, Scott? Do I have to get a little closer?
Actually, this seems just about right. Okay. And could you say your name?
Vincent Mariani.
Say it one more time.
Vincent Mariani.
Okay. Well, that seems like a good level.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
All right. Okay, what I wanted mainly to ask you about, and, you know, if you have an idea, you can go with it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not going to bother me.
Okay. I think it's an incredible idea. And I think I've thought of it, others, but no one I know has gone through with it, you know, to pursue it. So, anyway, what would you like to?
Why don't you talk a little bit about why you think bathroom graffiti occurs?
Oh, well, the other day when you and I talked, I immediately recalled, I'm 70 years old, and I do recall as a very young man, including junior high school and high school, that the graffiti in the restrooms was such a hot issue that the principal had to interrupt our classes and talk about this as a undesirable thing and how it was out of hand, and he felt that the criminal aspect had entered the school, that it was destructive and demented. And probably what I have to say is very, very simple and limited in it in terms of my experience. And that is simply, as a young man, in my recollection of the time, and certainly in terms of graffiti, is that there was far more repression, that sexual matters were still, as a result of the Victorian notion, like my parents and their grandparents, there were things that were so, these things would be outrageous. They were things that even young men didn't talk about to other young men. There were certain things that were kind of secret. So what I think it happened in my day was that the degree, it's a ratio, the degree of repression can be relatively viewed in the restrooms, where probably, maybe it has something to do with the nature of relieving oneself. You know, there's something very natural and basic that it somehow stimulates the idea of expressing and somehow putting in these secret places. It's a very, how would I say, individual matter, but somehow it taps the collective. So in a collective sense, my day, where repression was far greater than now, and my day was considered loose compared to my parents, so nothing new about that. But so the degree of repression can be seen, you know, in terms of the expression in graffiti. But what comes to mind now, and I hadn't thought about it, Scott, was what do you think about the caves of Lascaux, where the markings and the drawings are still visible in the ancient caves? I have a thought. Part of what I have come to understand about the markings in the caves of Lascaux, where you have hunters and bison and animals, was not just simply to record something, but to enforce and to nurture in a mystical sense the consequence of the hunt. You know, in other words, to say that the markings were on the cave walls to enhance, in fact, through magic, to be successful in the hunt. Well, don't you think, in a way, that in terms of graffiti, that there might be some relationship to that? That because of the repression and the unavailability I'm thinking of man's dream. Like in my day, partnership was very difficult, very rare. You know, nowadays in your time, our time, it's become a little more difficult. But what was 10 years ago? It was sort of more available. So I'm wondering, there's probably a ratio there of the availability of expression, sexual expression, in the opposite sex, and graffiti. So does it, in some instinctual way, are these drawings and things that are put on the wall, there's a relationship to what is not available in repression and the need, but also some strange ritual of the drawing and the marking. is there some primitive sense that by doing this, does it become more real? Does it become more available? I think it's a very complex act, I call it a ritual. So I'm amazed now when I go to restrooms that I hardly see anything at all. But what is available on the newsstands and what is available in films and in literature would absolutely been outrageous in my day. But I also remember when I was in the army, I joined the army as a young man in the latrines of the soldiers that were removed from society where women were not available. It was intense. So, you know, it was everywhere. So you see what I mean? It's like you could almost a mathematical ratio in terms of repression and the expression. And to create, I don't know why I'm thinking of the caves of Lascaux, but the less availability, the more picture, out-picturing to maybe help the hunt, you know.
Yeah.
There might be maybe some relationship there. I wonder, I've not talked to any females, but I have a sense that it's true in the restrooms of the ladies' room that probably is less and less. I feel now what I see in the restrooms, and of course, is more intellectual than raw and basic as it was in my time and years ago. I find this a very, very interesting question. Outside of that, you may want to ask me some questions. That's all that comes to my mind now.
Scott. Do you think that there is good bathroom graffiti or bad bathroom graffiti?
Well, I think yes. I think that in a sense, the overview is that you realize that human beings, male, female, have this primitive drive, you know, to express and to mark down in private areas. But I'll have to tell you a story that I also find somewhat relative to your project, is that I've lived in New York many times, you know, for entire summers at a time. And I remember the graffiti in the train stations and public buildings, and this was years ago, got out of hand. But you notice like in major cities, in big cities where there's a lot of tension, there's a lot of rawness, there's a lot of problem with traffic and interaction with people, that there seems to be more graffiti in areas where there doesn't seem to be as much intensity or drive or, let's say, overcrowded conditions and people coming from other countries and poverty and so forth. I find less graffiti. I've seen this as I travel. Now, could be that it's also a matter of parental influence and church and so forth. But have you ever been to New York?
Yes.
You know what I'm talking about. In fact, this is the point I wanted to make. This is about 15 years ago. Yeah, about 15, 20 years ago. I was watching TV, and of all things, they said the announcer said that they were actually in the gallery of a very prominent collector, director of a gallery, who formed a group show of the best of the graffiti artists in New York. Now, I saw this, Scott. I think his name was Zorro. See, they all have their names. Zorro gets to the mic. He was being interviewed. And the interviewer said, Zorro, you have a great reputation, but you're the only one that has refused to exhibit. And is there a reason? Zorro said, you bet there's a reason, man. I've got a reputation. I don't do my work in galleries. I do my work, I have to climb over electrified fences. I take a risk, man. What I do comes from the heart, from the spirit. It takes guts. I have a reputation. I'm not going to join this gathering where you're going to give me canvas and paint. That's not graffiti. That's not taking a chance. That's giving in to the process. That's doing the opposite of what I'm about. I'm a fighter. I'm a warrior. I have principles. This is ridiculous. This is like an insult to all of us to take this serious. And I thought, never realized, Scott, that a lot of the graffiti artists are like we are with our art, plus the risk factor. They could be shot, they could be imprisoned, they could be fined. But amongst the graffiti artists, there is a hierarchical order. There is respect. But you see, if you take away the risk, take away that they are fighting for in their own boroughs or for their own reasons, that they have the respect of their fellow artists and also of their areas. So do you see how ridiculous it is to give graffiti artists canvas and paint and brush? First of all, they use aerosol cans and sprays. And so isn't that interesting? So maybe you can think about what's the relationship between graffiti artists that do this as an expression, and then other graffiti that is done secretly and done to, let's say, enhance the hunt, or is it just repression that is expressed instinctively? And is it done for others to read, others to see, or is it done just on a personal basis? You know, there's quite a very, very interesting. And I did mention briefly when I went to Pompeii in Ostia Antica in Italy, where one of the guards brought me to a little panel. This was in Pompeii, and for, you know, a little, maybe a couple American dollars, he showed me, opened a little panel of something that was considered graffiti in the days of Pompeii. So it's been going on, I'm sure, since the beginning of consciousness. Or may I say, where there was a degree of morality to limit what is acceptable and unacceptable conduct. So you find another ratio there. What is imposed by a culture, and let's say the repression and the expression, as you try to hide, and then the secret, I guess, energies come forth. So it's very interesting. Basically, that's about all unless you have a question.
Oh, well, is it valuable as art?
To me, it's not art, but it has to do with culture, you know, and as documentation. See, the other thing, Scott, what is this? Is this in India? There's an entire architectonic structure with very explicit sexual action, but you see, in that culture of that time, procreation and sexual activity was viewed differently. And the fact that they were illustrating it wasn't just simply allowing, let's say, the inhibitions, you know, to be expressed, but it expressed a different sensibility. And I, if I find this, I think you should know about it. I'll try to get that for you. Well, Scott, I'll let you. I'm going to run back up to class, see how they're doing.
Okay.
And when you leave, just close the light and close the door, okay?
Okay, thank you.
You're
I
welcome.
Appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Yeah, I'm really pleased.
I'm impressed with you. That's good.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
Yeah, just make sure the door is closed.
I will. Take it easy.